Welcome to the Morikami Museum and our new exhibition, Collecting Stories. We've divided this exhibition to highlight our permanent collection into five vignettes. This one is Dressing the Modern Girl, and we are able to bring out several of our early 20th century kimono that represent a very exciting trend in kimono design, where we have traditional framework of the clothing, but the adoption of many Western aesthetic trends, such as Art Deco, Abstract Expressionism, and Cubism. In addition to that, the mechanization of weaving and the introduction of aniline dyes introduced a whole world of color and bold design that was not before possible. It was also more affordable, so many young women could embrace this new avant-garde world, and they were called moga, or modern girls. We have a painting that demonstrates a real interesting juxtaposition of East and West in Japan, circa 1930s. It's a woman dressed in a very bold, colorful kimono, but she has a new style hairdo. But she's supporting a very old and traditional icon of Japanese culture, and that is a bunraku puppet. And the female represented in this work of art, this puppet, is wearing all of the very old traditional Heian style, 10th century layers of robes and hairdo. So we have a very old world and new world combination. We also have a print here by Ishikawa Toraji, who is representing the Japanese female completely nude. Nudes weren't unknown in Japanese art, but this particular one shows a very new wave girl in her newly bobbed hairdo, completely nude and admiring herself brazenly in a mirror with a backdrop of all Western style wallpaper and curtains. And this was considered the height of decadency by a lot of cultural conservatives. So we have really an advance into the modern world with just a few objects on display here. In celebrating sake, we are able to highlight many of the Morikami's wonderful collection of sake-related cups and bottles and commercial containers. Sake has always been known as the drink of the gods in Japan, and it is of primary importance in most religious rituals, as well as seasonal events like cherry blossom viewing, weddings, and celebrating New Year's. It's also a basic form of etiquette in Japanese culture and demonstrates the highest level of politeness and exchange between two people in both the serving and drinking of sake. And we also represent many commercial type vessels, including large kegs, smaller ceramic containers that you would buy at a sake store and carry home with you. Each of those would carry the name of the sake shop's brand, so that they were also advertising. All of these things are both humble in their use, but in creation, considered some of the highest art forms in Japan. In Masquerade, we have on display several masks from various areas of Japanese culture, including theater, festivals, military, and cosplay or anime manga-inspired masks. Another type of mask that we have, two masks and one hand-painted jacket lining, represents a hanya. Hanya is more of a personality than an actual figure. And the hanya is associated with women, and specifically women's rage and jealousy. And that's a fearsome thing to behold. And the jacket lining shows a princess who is avenging her father's death. And in order to really take on that entire deep felt rage, she puts on a hanya mask and is able to avenge her father successfully. Last but not least, there are face masks that are part of samurai culture armor. And these not only anchor the helmet to the head and to the rest of the armor, but they cover the lower part of the face, the cheeks, the nose, and the chin. and usually have articulated teeth and mustaches or beards out of human hair that make them very fearsome indeed and make the entire ensemble of a samurai armor a very formidable presence in the face of the enemy. In sacred spaces, we have on display several articles of personal ritual worship. Before the 20th century, most homes had two small altars. One was a kamidana, which was devoted to the maintenance of a relationship with the natural world, or the gods or kami that inhabited the natural world, including the mountains, the streams, the rocks, and just general gods of good luck, like Ebisu and Daikoku. The other altar is called a butsudan, and this small, beautifully crafted, gilded cabinet contains a statue of a Buddha or a bodhisattva or even a painting of a Buddha. And this particular belief system, it was responsible for maintaining a relationship with your ancestors. We have a very impressive shrine on display from a Shinto compound dedicated to the god of rice, Inari. And this is a small building, a subsidiary building that would not have been accessible to the public. The public could walk up, clap two times and bow their head in prayer, but otherwise only a designated priest would be able to access. And inside this sanctuary is typically some object that represents a deity or an object of some kind of special worship. We also have a very interesting collection of bells at the Morikami. Two are on display here. One is a densho style bell, which is suspended and hit with a striker from the side, located on temple grounds. The other very special bell once belonged to Ripley of Ripley's Believe It or Not. And we acquired this bell in a very interesting way. The producer of Ripley's Believe It or Not acquired it from Rip when he passed away. This bell was said to have been used in the show, Believe It or Not, to ring in the show and then ring out the show. In A View of the Moon, we have several pieces that showcase the reverence held for the moon in Japanese visual culture. The full moon in a cherry blossom festival or in any harvest festival, known as Tsukimi, held in August of every year, is still a very important part of Japanese belief and worship. Shihoku Fukumoto is a very renowned shibori or textile artist. She works with indigo dyes. With this slight gradation and variation of her dyeing, she creates a very misty and timeless atmospheric piece. A very popular story most Japanese are familiar with is The Tale of the Bamboo Cutter. And we have that story represented in a print from Tsukioka Yoshitoshi, from his 100 Aspects of the Moon, as well as a contemporary doll. The story goes that a poor bamboo cutter, a basket maker, found an abandoned child. He and his wife adopted her. She was so beautiful, they named her Kaguya Hime, which means shining princess. Eventually, she revealed that she was actually the daughter of Joga, queen of the moon, and that she had to return. So in the print by Yoshitoshi, the poor bamboo cutter is seen wishing her well, but agonizing over her loss as she ascends to the heavens with her attendants at her side. Another part of the story is represented by the doll, who is wrapped in beautiful layers of silk kimono and her shimmering silver hair, supposedly meant to be a reflection of the moon. She's writing a poem to the emperor. The emperor was one of her suitors. She had to turn him away, but wrote him a poem and offered him a jar of elixir of mortality. Both of those he threw into the mouth of Mount Fuji, an active volcano, and wished for the immortality that she bestowed upon him. We have a contemporary piece showing Mount Fuji with a reflection of the full moon at its base by Morishita Kaz. We also have another contemporary work, or mid-20th century work, by Asano Hiroyuki, which is a very abstract interpretation of the shadow of the moon. Thank you for joining us today for a guided tour of collecting stories. I very much hope you enjoyed your virtual experience. Please visit us online at mordecai.org for all Mordecai happenings, and also follow us on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter to stay connected with us.